Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah.
How are you? Fine, all of you? From Ghana?
Yes, from Ghana.
Which area of Ghana are you from?
From Wa.
Wa, right?
Upper West.
North, I know, I went there. Yeah. And you?
The same place, sir.
Same Wa?
Yeah.
Yes.
Ashanti region.
Ashanti region, yes.
I'm your house town.
That's right, yes. Yeah. I've been to Wa and as well as to the Ashanti region. I've seen all the places. To Wa we went by helicopter because the roads were not good.
Yeah.
The distance in Wa was quite some, you know.
Just
How far away was it from Accra?
By road, I would say, because of the bad road.
That's right.
It takes about 10 hours.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, about 10 hours.
But 10 hours at the risk of your life.
Because of the road, it's very bad.
Because Accra to...
How far is it in mileage?
This about
by road.
It will be about 360 something.
That's right.
No.
So you can't do it in 10 hours.
Yeah.
In 10 hours you may reach up from there.
You
can't do that. 350 miles.
Yeah.
In 10 hours it's quite some speed. It's possible. In 2 days, I think, it will be more proper. Okay, let's begin with the questions, please.
Okay, my first question is, I'd like to start with you. I just want to know how you coped with life in Britain when you first migrated from Pakistan to Britain.
How did I do what?
How you coped with the lifestyle in Britain here when you first migrated from Pakistan.
Well, our lifestyle remains the same everywhere in the world. There's no question of my being in Britain or anywhere else when I went to Ghana.
Yeah.
My lifestyle remained the same as it is, as it was, and so on. Mm-hmm. So, if you change your lifestyle in going to some country, it becomes a very difficult proposition, doesn't it? Wherever you go, you begin to change your lifestyle. You keep your lifestyle, all right. So, you, when you came to England, did you change your lifestyle?
I didn't, but initially it was quite difficult for me because as a young guy, when I first arrived here, life here was different from what I was used to and what I was brought up.
And these things, these small things happen, you know. Small adjustments have to be made.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you don't have to change your lifestyle, in fact. Except, for instance, in your case, the type of food you are accustomed to.
Yeah.
If it was the traditional food of Africa, then of course you'll find it difficult. But in England, you get everything.
Yeah.
In the marketplaces, there are special marketplaces you can again where you can get if you like any type of African food you please. So you can still maintain your lifestyle easily in London, in particular. It's a very cosmopolitan city, isn't it?
Yeah.
Next, please.
I want to know where I'm working. There's not any Ahmadi mosque around there. Is it possible for me to join?
Where are you working? You haven't told me that, huh?
Yes, sir. I'm working in North London.
There are quite a few Ahmadis in North London. We have a regular Jamaat there. So only it is for you to get in touch with Imam Sahib and get the proper addresses and telephone numbers and you will be all the time with the Jamaat then, huh? Don't live a separate individual life. It's not safe. That is what should be the question, you know. People who come from Africa or anywhere else, settled in London, if they don't immediately get hooked on to some Jamaat, or at least with the center here, then they are like lost sheep of the house of Israel. Mm-hmm. They begin to drift away. So that's very important. You must discover other Ahmadis as well. I know there are quite a few from Ghana who have disappeared somewhere. Maybe it's not their fault. Maybe it is the, you know, lack of knowledge how to get on to some Jamaat. But still, it's a very, very dangerous thing for them to have. Right? Don't you realize that?
Yeah.
How long have you been here, by the way?
About nearly 5 years now.
5 years.
Yeah.
And how many times have you met before?
I think this is my first time for meeting you personally.
See, this is what I mean. There's some other Ghanaians who almost come here twice, 3 times a week. Say the Juma prayer regularly here. And also come in other meetings and participate fully in the life of Jamaat. So they have nothing to fear with the grace of Allah. But a loner anywhere is always in danger. Eh? Please.
Yusuf Adams.
Yes, Yusuf Adam.
Yeah. My question is, it's good for blood donation for help. Blood donation.
Blood donation is all right. I have donated blood many a time. And I don't see any reason why you should be hesitant about blood donation. Unless one receives blood donation these days, it could turn out to be a dangerous thing because of infected blood, the danger of infected blood being transfused into you. So that is a different proposition altogether. But what do you want to know about blood?
If I want to give blood to
no
the
problem. Go ahead. And write down his address. We, from time to time, Khudamul Ahmadiyya organizes blood donation because in Ahmadi case, with the grace of Allah, we have very healthy blood. And the people here appreciate the blood donation organized by Khudamul Ahmadiyya. There are some hospitals who offer special facilities for the group blood donation, etc. So you better be in touch with Imam Sahib and he'll put you on to Khudamul Ahmadiyya, right?
In my district, in Adansi district, we started blood donation in a big hospital
yes.
in Ashanti region.
Mashallah.
And that is AGC Corporation.
Mm-hmm. Are you from Kumasi?
Adansi, Ashanti, the same region.
The same region.
But the part of the Ashanti region, that's south. Mm-hmm. We started blood donation for time to time. In here, I started my as well in private in hospitals. Mm-hmm. I done 2 times in here. By some of my church friends, I talked with them about blood donation. He said they have said that blood donation is not good because health service, when you go to the lab and the blood drop down, they put strong acid on it. That's why.
On what?
Strong acid on blood when the blood drop down in the lab.
So what?
It's not good for service.
For what?
When you got laboratory.
I agree, I understand. But when the blood drops
down,
on the floor, they put acid on it.
Yeah.
So what harm? What then?
That's the Christian friend said that.
It's very stupid and superstitious.
That's it.
You see, most of the Ahmadis we have gained from Ashanti region have Christian background. They come from the Christian background.
Yes.
And so some of the superstitions also come along. Eh? But most of the Ahmadis we have in war region are from Muslim background. Am I right?
Yes.
That's right. And they have their own special type of superstitions there. There's no running away from superstition when you go to any society in the world nowadays. Even here in England, superstitions exist. And Russia is full of superstitions. It's not a prerogative of Pakistan or Africa to have superstitions. Everywhere in the world there are superstitions. But they should be shed. When you enter Islam, you should be unloaded with all the superstitions and walk in light and clean. This is what the Holy Quran says. Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam takes the loads away from the shoulders of the people. Of superstitions and things, and they enter Islam light-footed to carry the more honorable load of service to God. So if you are loaded with superstition, there is very little of you left available for the service to Islam. You have to be single-minded, dedicated, otherwise you really can't serve a cause. You understand the point?
Yes,
sir. Good. Please.
Next one is, what are your views on racism in Britain? What approach would you advise us to use, and what can we do to overcome this dilemma?
Mm-hmm. Have you been here for long?
Nearly 6 years.
That's right, yes. Yeah. I can see from your pronunciation that you have been here quite some time, and still you, like your friend or relative, are you friends or relatives?
Relatives.
Yeah. You have been hiding yourself from us for quite long, eh?
Actually, I used to live far away in the North Wales, that's in Bango.
But there are people here who live farther away, much, much farther, 700 miles away, but they keep coming.
Yeah.
It's actually only a matter of your being charged with the spirit and so on. So please remain in touch, okay? So the question is about?
Racism in Britain.
But I don't understand, why are you asking this question? Everybody knows that television programs present this. And racism, it's not just in Britain, it's everywhere.
Yeah.
It's raising its head. It remained dormant for a while, not very dormant, but to a degree, dormant for a while, during the East-West polarization. When there were communists pitched against the capitalists of the outside world, then because of the fear of racism further involving things and pushing people to communism, all the countries tried not to encourage racism to raise its head. Now this fear is over. Now everywhere in Europe and also everywhere in the third world countries, racism is raising its head. You see, when you say racism in Britain, you should also think of racism in Ghana, racism in Nigeria, racism in Sierra Leone. Everywhere it is it's raising its ugly head. And it should be condemned wherever it is. And every effort should be made, jointly if possible by different communities, to suppress the inclination towards racism. It's bad for people. Bad for the racists as well as for those who suffer at the hands of the racists. It's a two-way weapon with which they commit suicide. Racism always, I believe, has some roots in inferiority complex. If you deeply analyze, you know, those of the British or the Germans or others who are not jealous of other people, who are complacent and confident and live happily, they are very unlikely to entertain racism. Only those who see others coming from different countries and having a better way of life, achieving a better way of life, they become jealous. And this jealousy is rooted always in an inferiority complex. And everywhere, if you study the root causes of racism, you will find this jealousy working behind. And it works against the person who is jealous as well. You see, it's a very deadly poison. And that's why I advise even African Ahmadis when I go there, Afro-American Ahmadis, when I go to America, I tell them that it's against your own interest. Inferiority complex is a deadly poison. And racism, whether it's black racism or white racism or yellow racism is a satanic thing. It should be totally rejected by true believers. Don't you agree?
I agree.
That's right.
I want to know about marriage between a Muslim and a non-Muslim. Is it acceptable?
It depends. Whom are you contemplating to marry? It depends on whom you are contemplating to marry. The first address was to you, and now it is general. If one chooses a good girl of chaste habits and pious inclinations, whatever her religion is, she is very likely to become Muslim very soon after she is transferred from the non-Muslim environments to the Muslim environments and Muslim way of life. I've seen such girls in Germany, in England, elsewhere, who married Ahmadi Muslims of sound, good habits, you know. They themselves were pure. And they asked my permission. I said, go ahead and marry them, but choose the right sort of girl. And they all became very good, devout Muslims, mashallah. There was no element of any racism ever displayed by them. And they felt at ease and comfort in the Islamic Muslim society. And in fact, after a while, they fell in love with this way of life. They feel more at peace. He's a special messenger sent by my daughter. Good. Take care. I'm coming for a while. I'll come for a while. In the meantime, you take over. Huh? Please. Next, please.
My next question is from Quran, Holy Quran, chapter 55, verse 28. All that is on the earth will pass away. And that question is for the Muslims. And one of Christian friends said that in this earth, all things, good things will remain and the bad things will reject from God. And those who are doing good things will use that good things in this earth. I need more ideas from you, please.
You see, there are two different things you're talking about. There is one universal principle mentioned in the Holy Quran,
yeah,
that whatever is good has a staying power.
Yeah.
It comes to stay. Now, it's a very profound statement, because otherwise you'll see that after good, evil comes and takes over again, then wave after wave you see good and evil. And then what is the meaning of this statement of the Holy Quran, that the good comes to stay?
That is Quran chapter.
No, I know, I know. I'm telling you, the meaning is deeper than meets the eye. The fact is that if you study the human progress and human civilization, you will learn that at every stage, when goodness conquered evil and became transcendent over the evil habits, after a while it lost again,
yes,
to evil. But the level to which goodness was raised never went back to the original level from it started. The level is always raised higher. See, the civilization which we now inherit commonly as human beings, although it has many bad points, but there is far more understanding and care and regard for good things of common decency than, say, 1,000 years ago. There to kill, to murder, to attack without rhyme or reason was just small, ordinary thing. There were no human rights concepts, no basic fundamental rights for man to live with his ideologies and ideas, and a reaction against all such forces which want to suppress human ideal. That was non-existent in previous years. So at every level, wave after wave, of course we move on from a crest to trough, from goodness to evil. But the level of goodness goes on rising. There's some good qualities which are left behind to stay, like the sediments in the sea. Even if they're made very slowly, ultimately they begin to show up and islands are born. So this is the meaning of the Quranic statement, that goodness ultimately prevails and comes to stay. And the example given is that of a flood. where the heavy material settles down and the froth is wasted. But the second statement is of quite a different type and character. It has nothing to do with this. The second statement is about the life on earth. It will not be forever. Nothing will live but God.
MashaAllah.
That is the meaning of that.
Okay.
Right? Now, you come and take over from me and continue discussion. I'll come after a while. Huh? Please. Permitted?
Yes, sir. Sir.
Without break, continue.
So, as Huzoor has instructed us that we should continue, I think your question is already quite explained by Huzoor.
Yeah.
There is nothing left.
Okay.
As he mentioned, I think the verse of the Quran, the two verses of the Quran which we have quoted, they carry very profound message and much more deeper meanings are there, and he has already spoken about that. But one very simple meaning I can say is that people say generally, and it is quite right in accordance with this verse of the Quran, that if a person is of such a character who gives a benefit to other people, who is useful for other people and always spreading goodness, Allah Almighty also, yes, please get some chairs. Yes, they will provide you the chairs. Please tell them. Also, Allah Almighty also blesses in his life and he is granted longer life as well, because the one who is always in the service of mankind, he naturally earns and gets the prayers of other people as well. If, for example, you are a good person helping the mankind, helping the widows, helping the orphans and other people, so naturally everybody would be praying for you. And the more you are helpful, the more prayers you will get. And as a result of that, Allah Almighty would bless the life span of that person, and he would be in service for a longer time. Even so much so that I remember that there is one hadith of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which he has mentioned that when a person dies, everyone has to die one day. When a person dies, then so far as those actions are concerned, which he used to perform during his lifetime, they naturally come to an end. And that is in a way the end of his earning any reward. But the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned that even after the death of a person, there are certain things which continue to earn him more and more reward and sawab from Allah Almighty. And one of those things, for example, he has mentioned that if somebody is there who does a charitable work, like for example building a bridge or building some well or some other things from which people derive benefit, like planting a tree which gives shade and fruit and other things, as long as those things are there, his reward would be continue added to his credit, because he is doing something good and people continue to benefit even if that person is no longer there. The second example, which we should all remember, because these are the things we get the light and blessing from Allah Almighty, and we should always keep all these things in mind. The second example he has given is that if a person is given some knowledge and then he spreads that knowledge, so as long as the people are going to benefit from that knowledge, his reward is going to be added to his credit. And first and foremost in this case of knowledge is the knowledge of the Holy Quran, knowledge of the sayings of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and other religious matters. So if a person is gifted with the religious knowledge and then he tries to spread that knowledge, teaches other people, like the Holy Quran, if I know the Holy Quran, I should be teaching it to others. If you know the Holy Quran, you should be teaching it to others. So in this case, all the children who would learn from you, and then later on they would act according to the Holy Quran and continue to benefit from the wisdom and the knowledge contained in the Holy Quran. So all these things will continue to add to your reward and blessings of Allah Almighty. So that is the second example, that knowledge also comes into that category, and people will continue to earn their reward even after their death. The third example the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned is of a good progeny. Everyone has to pass away, as I mentioned. and as is a fact, you know, mentioned in the Holy Quran, and that is exactly the meaning of that verse of the Holy Quran which you quoted, "Kullu man alayha fan." Everyone on the surface of the earth has to pass away. So, as this is a reality, so the Holy Prophet ﷺ says that three categories particularly are those which would continue to earn their reward, and the third example he has given is of good progeny. If a person leaves behind good children, well-educated, well-trained, and well-equipped with religious knowledge, with piety, with Islamic values and moral values, so as long as those children are there and acting according to those values and teachings, then they would be good people. They would be doing good, spreading goodness all around them. So then these children would also be praying for their deceased parents. And in that sense, his status in the eyes of Allah would continue to be raised. So in this way, you know, he has given three specific examples. So that is also one way of the extending of one's life, how the life is going to be extended and how the useful people are going to be granted a longer span of life, longer period of stay in this world. And I think that is quite clear. Now we attend to this friend. You were here last Friday when we spoke together. And so what is your name, sir?
Sulaiman Daud.
Sulaiman Daud.
Yeah.
And you come from?
From Nigeria.
From Nigeria, yes, that's right. Yeah. So previously we were all talking about Ghana, so now we have the Nigerian representation as well. Sulaiman Daud. And how long have you been Ahmadi?
I'm born Ahmadi.
Born Ahmadi, yes. I think when you were asked that how long have you been here and how often did you come, perhaps you were mentioning that you are attending this meeting for the first time.
Yeah.
But you have been coming to the mosque before?
Yeah.
You have been?
Yeah.
Do you come regularly to?
Yeah, I do.
You come regularly for the Friday prayer?
Yeah.
And, but sometime you come?
Yeah.
So you have been to the London Mosque quite a few times and attending the Friday prayers?
Yeah.
Okay, that's right. And you are also coming here regularly?
All the time.
Yes. All of the time, mashallah. And what about you, Sulaiman?
Yeah.
You're also coming here regularly?
Yeah, I've been coming regularly. Yeah.
And how long have you been here in this country?
Yeah, I came last year.
Last year?
I see.
And where are you living at the moment?
I live in Essex, outside London, actually.
Quite far away from here?
Oh, quite far. It takes about 2.5 hours to get there.
About 2.5 hours to get over here, I see.
So that's why I'm even late.
So you have got some questions to ask from Huzur?
Actually, I got, but I can't really fathom it now. But actually, I was thinking about Waqf-e-Nau.
Yes.
A question, my question just came to my mind about Waqf-e-Nau. And I was thinking of the institution itself. How is it that, in a way that, is it that the child, is it supposed to be a fully missionary or in terms of being a religious missionary?
Mm.
Or is there a way it could be, I'm trying to look at intricacies that,
I mean, what the child would be or what the child would be required to do?
Yeah, well, what would the child be? Actually, in terms of taking some further education, maybe secular education.
Yes, yes.
Maybe trying to be a much doctor or an engineer.
Yes.
And the problem is, how far does he have to go with some Islamic orientation along, apart from maybe little that the father can give, the lecture or teaching stuff.
Yes.
So that is the my main crossroads.
Yes.
I don't know if I'm clear about that now.
No, I think that's a very good question, and I think when Huzur comes in a few minutes' time, then he would elaborate that, and I think we should wait for that time.
Yes.
But I can tell you that this question, inshallah, would be very useful. The answer would be very useful for all our viewers, because this new scheme of dedication of children is a very important scheme. And the response by the grace of Allah from all over the world has been very, very encouraging and very inspiring. And Huzur also mentioned once that although, I mean, it's not possible for anybody to find out the, you know, whether the male child is going to be born or a female child. But those people who make this sort of commitment, even before the birth of the child, and that is one of the requirements in Waqf-e-Nau, that the commitment should not be made after the birth of the child, it should be made before the birth of the child. So those people who having trust in Allah and with full dedication and submission they make this decision that whatever child we are going to be blessed with, we are going to dedicate the child for the service of Islam. He says that, you know, God Almighty has shown us a very special miracle and blessing in the sense that there are more male children as compared with the number of the female children. Nobody can determine that, and nobody can ever have any estimation or guesses about that. But this is how Allah Almighty has shown us. The more male Waqf-e-Nau children are there as compared with female children. And although the female children, they are also going to play their part very importantly in this great scheme. And you know, not only in this way that maybe these Waqf-e-Nau female children are going to get married to Waqf-e-Nau male children, and both of them, husband and wife, working together, you know, for the same cause. And secondly, these female children, they can be their own, serving the cause of the community independently. I mean, they can also carry out their research work. There are so many jobs to be done by ladies, and some of the jobs could only be done by ladies. So in this way, they are going to contribute and play their role very effectively in this field. And I think both of them, they are going to, you know, equally important. This scheme is very blessed, you know, from so many angles. One thing is that the parents, they make a decision on behalf of their children. As a matter of fact, the life has to be dedicated by the person who wants to dedicate the life. But when we say that in the Waqf-e-Nau scheme, the parents have to dedicate their children, as a matter of fact, they undertake a sort of responsibility upon them that we are going to look after our children in such a way that they really come up to be such children who are ready to rededicate themselves when they are in a position to make their own decision and judgment. A child, you know, from the early childhood, the parents would be always putting this message into the ears of the children that, well, we have dedicated you, you are a Waqf-e-Nau child, and that would go a long way towards the upbringing of such children. And when the children are grown up, say 10 years old or 12 years old, when they are, you know, able to think and make up their own mind and decisions, then hopefully, inshallah, as a result of this training from their parents, the children would themselves reaffirm this decision that, well, we are ready to serve the cause of Islam. So inshallah, that is really going to be a great, you know, big start of that day. So from the very beginning, from the very first day, it becomes a responsibility of the parents to look after the children. And as you know, I mean, I'm talking in a general term, but I think if the message is to go to the parents of the Waqf-e-Nau children, then they should always be reminded of the fact that even before the process of birth of a child starts, Allah Almighty and His Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has taught us that the parents, they should be praying for good and blessed progeny. Even before the process starts of the birth of the children, before the, you know, relationship develops between husband and wife, even at that time they should be praying for that. And then when the child is born, during the pregnancy, the mother is advised to read the Quran and to always think in good terms and also offer the prayer and do all the good things, because the effect of all those things is going to be inherited and going to be received by the child yet to be born. And that all is a medical thing, medically proved thing, that the children, they could have the good effect of the acts of the mother during the period of pregnancy. And after the birth takes place, then the very first action all the Muslims are required to do is that they should be saying the azan, the wording of the call for prayer, azan, in the right ear, and the wording of the ikamat in the left ear. Now generally a question is asked, what is the significance of that? I mean, the child, newly born child, is totally unable to understand at all. And if we are speaking in a different language, I mean Arabic, azan is in Arabic, ikamat is in Arabic, so the child won't be able to understand anything at all. But still the instruction is there. There is a deep and profound message behind it. That one is that medical science has proved that the child is definitely affected by whatever one hears or looks around. So whatever message goes into the ear, that does create its own effect to some degree. Secondly, it is a message for the parents. When they say the azan in the ear of the child, and say the ikamat. As a matter of fact, this is a very strong message to the parents that now a great blessing of Allah has been given to you by way of the child which has been blessed. Allah Almighty has blessed the child, blessed you with the child. Now it is your responsibility to see to it that your child becomes a regular worshipper. And he is very regular in the prayer. Because in early stages of life, it is the responsibility of the parent to see to it that the children are trained properly and all the teachings are given to them, moral values and other things they are properly told to them. So this is the responsibility of the parents to look after that. So I think this message, which is generally taken as a small ritual, that when the child is born, somebody is asked to come and to say the azan and the ikamat, and they try to distribute some sweets after that, and it is taken like this. It is not simply that thing, you know. Of course, it's a happy occasion, and barked with a special religious ritual, which is the saying of the azan, and distribution of sweets and all that is very good. The prayer on that occasion is very good. All these things are very good. I mean, these are exactly the part of the teachings of Islam. But much more than that, a deeper message is there that, one should not lose a single moment before the process of tarbiyat, the training of the children, should start. So I think the parents of Waqf-e-Nau children, they should be very clear about it. And it is due to this tarbiyat that they are going to become, by the grace of Allah, good members of the community and also good servants of Islam and good ambassadors of Islam. Because when Huzoor launched this campaign, this scheme of Waqf-e-Nau many years ago, he made it very clear that we need a large party, large army of ambassadors and missionaries of Islam. And ambassadors of Islam and servants of Islam in the sense, some would become missionaries, some would be doing some research work, some would be doing some other thing. But anyway, they would all be serving the cause of Islam, cause of religion. And this is the ultimate objective. But when you will ask the question, I'm sure that Huzoor would further explain this point, and that will be the real guidance coming directly from him. So I would like, when you are here, that mention one thing more, that last time when we had a group of Ahmadis from Sierra Leone and from Gambia, Huzoor mentioned that we have to find out all the Ahmadis living in this country, and I think the same should go to other countries as well. Wherever our African brothers are living, and we know for certain that many, many of them are here and there, in so many places from various countries. Either they have come for settlement, some have come for training, some for education, some for business, for whatever purpose may be. As long as they are here, they should be the member of the community here. As long as they are in Germany, they should be member over there. So, but I think we have to work hard to find out where these people are. I know that we have got some list of members from Ghana, from Sierra Leone and others, but the need is there that this list should be really updated. And we should complete this list in every sense of the term with full particulars, and these people should be encouraged to come regularly, very often, as far as it may be possible. This is again something we can talk in general very importantly, that the one who is very closely attached to the community, that is really, the member of the community. And this is, clearly mentioned in so many ahadith of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that if a person is attached to the community, then that is a safe person, safe and secure, and one can say that, I am fully attached with it, I am a part of the community. And moreover, the members of the community, they have been described as various parts of the body. You remember that hadith where the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned that the Muslims in a society, they are like the various limbs and parts of the body. If one part of the body is feeling a pain, then all other members, they also feel the pain. If there is a problem with an eye, for example, nobody would say that, the problem is with my eye alone and rest of my body is all right. But the whole body would become restless if there is a problem with one eye, with one ear, or with one tooth sometime. There is a toothache, the person becomes restless. So the same should be, as a matter of fact, the attitude of the whole Muslim society, And if one member is there and all other people, they should be taking care of that member. If that person is in distress, they should go and offer the help. And, you know, in this way, everyone should really become a part of the Muslim community. And that is why it is very important that we should know each other. And all the members, you know, so far as various desks are concerned, they should be having their complete listing, and regular meetings should be there. And those who are living far away, if they cannot come to this mosque, for example, in the case of this country, we have our branches everywhere. As you mentioned about North London, you are living there. So we have a community there. I will give you the address, and you can be in contact with them. They hold their Friday prayers and other, you know, evening prayers, and, you know, as far as it may be possible, then hold their monthly meetings and tabligh meetings and others. So the community is already there in every part of the country. Even in Essex, where you live, if I come to know exactly which area is that, I can tell you which is the nearest jamaat. In Barking, yes. So that is closer to you, yes. So in every case, somebody must be attached to that one. So this is the overall, you know, in the whole country, whether you are coming from North Wales, you mentioned about Bangor.
Yeah,
that was near, I remember, yes. Mm. There was another Ahmadi doctor as well living there,
yeah.
Dr. Aladdin.
Mm.
I don't know whether you know him
or not. I know there was a, what is it called, an Ahmadi Jamaat in Prestatyn, I went there a couple of times,
right. Yeah, that's right.
Even went there for Friday prayers. Yes. Yeah.
So this is the overall setup of the community, that if a lonely Ahmadi is living in one place and which is quite far away, but we always attach that Ahmadi to the nearest branch of the Jamaat, wherever it may be, so that that person can visit them, you know, as often as may be possible, and make their contribution there, go for the prayers, for the Friday prayers, for general meetings, and also be in contact with the missionary in that area and the president of the community over there. So everyone has to be a part of the community, and it's very essential, because as they say, unity is strength. And one of the outstanding feature of our community is that we are, by the grace of Allah, a very organized community. Organized in the sense that this organization, parallel of that, is not to be seen elsewhere. And moreover, with reference to one hadith of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he has mentioned that the outstanding quality of that one, you know, organized people from among the people of the latter day would be that they would be ala wahi al jamaat. In Arabic, he mentioned, when he was asked that how to find out that one group which would be on the right path as compared with others. So he said ala wahi al jamaat, that it is one organized jamaat, which means one leadership, one Khalifa is there, and all members of the community are very closely attached to one another, and they are all listening to what the instruction Hazur gives. They listen and obey, and they follow his instruction. So this is the image and the quality of the Jamaat, and that feature is to be found in our community alone. This sort of organization we don't see anywhere in any other Muslim community. So that's a very clear indication of Al Jamaat.
Yes. Not just Ghana of Monopoly, but
yes, that's right.
One Nigerian at least. Huh? Now let's start with where you left.
Yes.
You have been keeping them busy, haven't
yes,
you?
Yes, yes. I've been continuing with them, and our friend from Nigeria, he would like to ask a question about Waqf-e-Nau. So I just told them some detail about
the scheme.
Just asking about the institution of Waqf-e-Nau, and that in terms of education for the child itself, or the line, the field itself, is generally not designated to be purely maybe Mubalik, that's a religious missionary, but in terms of maybe it goes into other fields, secularly field, like engineering or doctor or other fields. My fear is at a point in time it's not necessarily as a Waqf-e-Nau, maybe much of a religious indoctrination. I mean, not in terms of how you pray, I mean, not this, but is it really essential that he has imbibed some that missionary ethics and etiquette into him? On how far?
We have, with the grace of Allah, a regular wakalat created for this purpose. So Imam Ali Sahib was a professor of psychology. He was a professor at the TA College. He dedicated his life and as of since he's working as Waqf-e-Zindagi himself. He is made the in charge and wakil for this Waqf-e-Nau department. Now he is well educated and well experienced in this task of how to bring up children ideally to suit the ultimate purpose of their training, etc. So he with others, with the help of other Ahmadi scholars and rabbis, has prepared a very well organized program which has been circulated to all the countries of the world, in which the idea of how a Waqf-e-Nau child should be raised has been expressed, and not only expressed but also demonstrated and illustrated with the help of this and that and that. So if the Jamaats try to benefit from that, it will become very easy for every Jamaat in the world to raise their Waqf-e-Nau children in harmony with the rest of the children of Waqf-e-Nau in the world. So you won't have a separate program for Ghana, separate for Nigeria, separate for England, but a harmonious single program in which Ahmadi children everywhere in the world will be brought up and trained and specifically educated for the purpose of being dedicated minded. This is the most important thing. Now you talk of different professions, of course we'll need such children when they grow up in so many different professions. For the service of Islam is not always in the area of Murabbi, so many other areas. Yet being Waqf-e-Nau, it is not enough for them to become professionals and serve the cause. They should also be well trained in religion, and they should be well educated in the way the prayers are held and this and that, so they can lead a religious life and also become religious leaders of a sort in whichever field they work. This is the purpose and plan of this Waqf-e-Nau. So inshallah, your country will not be left out of it. It has not been left out, I should say. The plan has been submitted to all the countries of the world. Waqf-e-Nau secretaries have been created everywhere, and it is their job to understand the plan, familiarize themselves with it fully, and then implement it in their own countries. If they don't do, then it's their fault and you should be on the watch out. See? You can inquire from your own secretary of Waqf-e-Nau from Nigeria, for instance. How many children are you taking care of? What's your plan? If he sends a weak, non-convincing answer, pass it on to me. Then I'll bring them to books, you know, why? Right? Good. Please?
My next question is, Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world today, mm-hmm. and the Ahmadiyya community is fast expanding in population worldwide. What can we, as adults and Ahmadis, do to help spread Islam? This country.
On this I have been speaking many times, various sermons have been delivered by me, particularly addressing this issue of Dawat al-Allah. And with the grace of Allah, after a long, long effort in relation to Ghana, and after many attempts which failed previously to wake up the lions of Ghana to Ahmadiyyat, ultimately, I'm glad to tell you that they have awakened, mashallah. They're rising with full consciousness of being God's representatives on earth. And they are spreading the message in Ghana like never before in the history of Ghana. Even in the best days of the early preachings,
such great achievements were unheard of. You have, you are either you have or you are about to cross the 100,000 target for conversion for per 1 year. And previously, I hope you remember that the rate of conversion had slowed down ultimately to about a few hundred. And I kept on telling them, for God's sake, what are you doing? You have the potential. Ghanaian Jamaat is a is an excellent Jamaat. It's a long, I know that, you know. They're generous people, they're dedicated, they're resolute, and they want to serve the cause. So I was so disgusted when I saw so many lions of Ahmadiyyat sleeping in their dens, not waking up. So at last, you know, I told the ladies during one of our annual meetings at the conference that, all right, take the cudgel in your own hands and leave your husband sleeping or sisters, brothers and fathers. Go ahead and enter the field. That somehow, you know, worked. That pinch was felt by the men and they resolved, no, no, we'll do it. And they did it, mashallah. So great things are happening in Ghana, of which you lost here are not aware. So you do exactly what they have been doing there. Do exactly as other Da'in al-Allah have been doing in Europe, in Germany, also in Belgium, in Holland, here as well, but to a smaller degree. You should first of all train yourself to become an ideal missionary who would attract others without anybody taking interest in your personality. It will be very, very unreal for them to accept or be interested in your faith either. It always happens that a person who is well charged with a mission and who has disciplined himself ideally, so that he becomes a very attractive figure. It so happens that such people have become the center of interest for others around them. They begin to take notice. They're very gentlemanly people. They're so different from the rest of the run of the society. They're exceptional in their conduct, in their promises, in their bearing. They take note of it, and their humans are provided by God with that inner sight. It never misses these points. Once they become interested in you, then they naturally are gravitated towards you and find out more about your mission, your beliefs, your ideologies, your way of life, and so on. And they inquire, the inquiry, the search begins from them. And they don't run away from it. If your personality is uncharmed, without charms, without attraction, then you have to speak to others about your message, and if they're not interested in you, they would not be interested in your message. You know, what do you mean by that? We don't want to be people like you, you know, that sort of thing. So it is highly important to improve the quality of your personality and make it really attractive. And with the grace of Allah, Ahmadis have been blessed by Allah with that special personality which attracts the world around. The other day, some person who is translating the cases of Asians, Africans, etc., who do not understand, that person is translating them in the courts where there are some cases hanging. And it is a lady who is doing it, and she told me that the magistrates and other officers before whom the cases are presented, they're all surprised that when an Ahmadi comes, they have already begun to recognize him. And they say it is not difficult at all. One of the magistrates inquired from this lady, tell me what do you do to your people? They come from various countries, you know, from Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, African countries. And when an Ahmadi appears, we know this is has to be an Ahmadi, because that has a very special bearing, dignity, responsibility, a sense of honor, far more truthful, if not entirely at least, far more truthful than others who seek asylum, for instance, or come for other, or are involved in different cases. So this is what I mean, that special character of Ahmadiyya, which it can only be created if you are godly. Because when you become godly, then Allah's attributes are attractive. They transform your personality, and then more weight is added to your message. Otherwise, you speak from the mouth and it reaches the ears, neither it rises from the heart nor it sinks into the hearts. So it is your personality which has to be godly, which would work. And once you are charged with that personality, then preaching becomes just a matter-of-fact thing, you know. You automatically, with the grace of Allah, are guaranteed success by God. Right?
Okay.
And the arguments do come, of course.
Yeah.
You can read them, but they come on the way, on the stride.
I'd just like to give an example, because my work colleagues, actually they are fascinated by my lifestyle sometimes, because I fast during the month of Ramadan,
yes,
talk to them about prayers and going to the mosque, and they really like my way of living.
And your recent behavior. And
yes.
This is it, exactly.
Yeah. And sometimes they make comparison to other Muslims.
But don't let them stop at your personality.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
push them forward into Islam.
Yeah.
From which you gained this personality, which you borrow. You were influenced by Islam and Ahmadiyyat, and this is the making of you.
Yeah.
Tell them, look here, I have a message as well.
Yeah.
If you want to be like me, if you like me, come on, I'll tell you how to be like me.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. And sometimes they make comparison to other Muslims who doesn't follow the teachings.
Naturally, yes.
Yeah.
They drink and they eat, even eat pork. Many have unfortunately started doing it, and they're just interested in the worldly affairs and gaining of the wealth and things, and their personalities are made according to their inner motives, intentions, and the psyche, which is gradually influenced by one's character. So these things are visible to man. Even the dullest knows a good man when he comes across one, whether he admits it or not, but everybody knows. Right?
Yeah,
good.
Yes.
My question is...
1 minute or what? 1 minute, yes please.
From Holy Quran chapter 23 verse 17.
Yes.
He said, then on the day of resurrection will you be raised up?
Yes.
I want to know, if you died by accident and you exploded, how can you raise you up to judge you? That's a question I want to know from them.
First of all, it is wrong to think that this body of yours will be raised up. Right?
Yeah.
If you die at a ripe old age or beyond the ripe old age of 105 years, will you be raised up in the same body, you know? All bent over yourself and weak, eh?
No.
And if you are ugly hair, if you are without sight, without hearing, or have other congenital defects, you're a hunchback, for instance, would you be raised up in that?
Sorry.
Will you be raised up like a hunchback?
No.
In the hereafter, a blind man,
no.
A deaf man?
No.
So then, obviously, it is not the same body will be raised. It will be a spiritual body which would be raised. Otherwise, there is no fun in collecting the sort of people here we find it in the heavens, with all their debilities and rheumatisms and, you know, backaches and heart problems. Because when you die with a disease, then that is a diseased body which is buried. And if you think it is that body which has to be raised, all the diseased people will be collected in the heaven. It will become a hospital instead of heaven, you know. So it has to be spiritual rebirth, not the physical rebirth. Okay?
Thank you.
All right. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.